Hello and welcome to our news conference today. My name is Norman Solomon. I am the national coordinator of rootsaction.org, and the organization, which is the 501c4 that sponsors Roots Action, which is called Action for a Progressive Future, has sponsored research for the autopsy on the Democratic Party that has been released this week. The Democratic National Committee and the National Democratic Party as a whole has declined to do an autopsy, which is unusual, especially after a national loss. The losing party especially is usually eager to conduct an autopsy and assess what went wrong and try to make it better for the future. That was not the case this time. And so it was a responsibility, in a sense, for people to pick up the thread, to take the step of initiating and implementing a detailed, in-depth autopsy, not only to look back at the 2016 election, but at this stage, much more importantly, to go forward to see what can be learned from that experience so that the tragedy of the 2016 election won't be repeated. And so an independent task force went ahead and conducted what we are calling autopsy, the Democratic Party in crisis. It's a 33-page document. It's public and available to anyone, any organizations or individuals, to repost and republish in its entirety. We're on the web at democraticautopsy.org. That's democraticautopsy.org. The autopsy report begins with an analogy that after a train wreck, it's essential when investigators come in for them to understand why the train wreck occurred. And that's most important to try to assess the factors that were preventable. And rather than trying to concentrate on pointing fingers on factors beyond the control of those running the railroad system and so forth, the emphasis, understandably, is on what was done that could have been prevented, that could have been done differently. And contrary to the approach that the National Democratic Party and the DNC have taken in the last year, this autopsy concentrates not on pointing fingers at other real or alleged factors external to the operations and policies and priorities of the party, but quite the opposite. The autopsy focuses on what the party did, what it didn't do, and especially in retrospect, what should have been done differently and what must be done differently to meet the twin goals that are focused on in this autopsy. The first being to defeat the right-wing Republican juggernaut, and the second to be advanced for the long-term, genuinely progressive policies in this country. We're going to be hearing from Karen Bernal, who is the now third term chair of the Progressive Caucus of the California Democratic Party, along with myself, Norman Solomon. She coordinated the entire activity that brought us this autopsy report, the task force that put it together. Karen has been an official in some capacity at some levels of the California Democratic Party since the year 2005, so this is what, a dozen years and more that Karen has been directly involved. She's currently, as she has been in the past, on the executive committee of the California Democratic Party, and I'm very pleased to now introduce Karen Bernal.
Well, thank you, Norman, and thank you all for being here. You know, one of the things Let me just go into what everyone already knows first off, just to start. During the 2016 general election, the party did experience a fall off of voter turnout and support among people of color, the young, and the working class. Much of our report concentrates on assessing the party's approach to these demographic groups. And yes, this paper does aim to serve as a nationwide discussion paper and stimulus for transformational action. The goal is clarity for the challenges ahead to end Republican rule and to gain lasting momentum for progressive change. And this isn't just only about the wins, but it's about energizing as well as expanding the base of the party. And I think one of the things, the problems that we are having is because of the lack of turnout, we have a problem of basically a kind of diminishing of the party base. And this is really important when we consider that in this past election, as everyone knows, we had a great millennial turnout for the primaries. Senator Bernie Sanders won the millennial vote. But beyond that, we need to understand that they are the future of the party. And when we can see that nationally, 8% of the millennial vote went to third-party candidates, and that in the crucial battleground states, that statistic was even higher, that this party has a very big problem when it comes to a very important demographic of its base. Similarly, it's sad to say, but the party also reaped the very bad outcome of a declining African American vote. From 2012 to 2016, the African American vote it went down by 7 percentage points. So that in these swing states, particularly Michigan, Indiana, Wisconsin, the voters decided to stay home. And that is a choice. I mean, We know that we had when we have to look into, and I hope the party prioritizes voter disenfranchisement, but it doesn't account for the lack of voter enthusiasm and the fact that staying home is also a choice in addition to voting for any one of the candidates. More than that, though, we need to be aware of the fact that the party continues to operate in an approach that is not in keeping with the times. We are in a period of social movements, and these social movements are part of what's taking place in the larger political landscape. And unfortunately, the party still wants to practice what we call silo politics, where we have, it's an exploitation, a neoliberal exploitation of identity groups and chase after an ever-shrinking universe of these white suburban voters or what they call white working class. And the problem that we see with this is that, number one, we can see that the working class, for instance, is going to be majority people of color very quickly here, and especially so with the age demographic of the 25 to 34-year-olds. They will be the majority of the working class in 2021, just a year after the next presidential election. And so these two demographics, which have in the past often the needs or prioritizing of these groups having often being pitted against each other, are now coming together and they are intersecting, and the party still does not have a plan for it. Unfortunately, we see this in evidence even now with the Virginia race, the governor's race that's coming up, and this doesn't bode well for the future because this is the class that would be the party's base. So I want to stop right there and if that's okay, and see if Norman has a little bit more to say. Can I just leave this there?
Sure. Okay. Thank you, Karen. And after a few more comments, I want to invite questions. I think it's notable that we're talking not only about what went wrong, but this autopsy report, which again is on the web at democraticautopsy.org, calls for some very specific steps that need to be taken by the Democratic National Committee and National Democratic Party leadership as a whole. I'd like to run through some specific recommendations included in the report. One is that, in keeping with the findings in this report, which frankly I found very shocking in working on it, that the Democratic National Committee, despite all of the horrific voter suppression laws in many states, has devoted minimal resources to fighting against these abrogations and abridgments of people's power. And so as late as May of this year, there was a grand total of one full-time staff person at the Democratic National Committee to challenge voter suppression. It's just really stunning. And then they announced in May of this year that they were going to gear up to a grand total of four after a grand total of one. Well, this is a big country, and I hate to think of the amount of money spent on food and drink by the DNC in ratio to the money that was spent for that one full-time staff person in the midst of the horrific assault on voting rights throughout the election year last year. As the saying goes, past is prologue, and here we are. And so the report, Autopsy, the Democratic Party in Crisis, specifically calls for, and I'll quote here, "The Democratic National Committee must make up for lost time by accelerating its very recent gear up of staffing to fight against the multi-front assaults on voting rights that include voter ID laws, purges of voting rolls, and intimidation tactics," unquote. We have heard and seen a lot of news lately, revelations that are not new, but there's more specifics coming out about how the Democratic National Committee functioned in an undemocratic way throughout the primary and caucus season for the 2016 presidential nomination process. And quoting here from the autopsy that has been issued independently this week, "The Democratic National Committee should commit itself to scrupulously adhering to its charter, which requires the DNC to be even-handed in the presidential nominating process." Related to the issue of democracy is, of course, that of the superdelegates, which got a lot of discussion in the press last year. The path forward to have a democratizing process in the Democratic Party is to end the voting power of all superdelegates. And our autopsy report specifically points out that, in our words, the voting power of all superdelegates to the Democratic National Convention must end. And that's because the superdelegate system, by its very nature, undermines the vital precept of one person, one vote. We're also elaborating in the autopsy report about the role of social movements, that social movements must not be seen and cannot be accurately understood as a tool to get candidates elected, that social movements are not a subset of election campaigns for social change. It's rather the opposite, that if there's a healthy relationship between election campaigns and social movements, then those campaigns are subsets and a part of the broader efforts to achieve genuine progressive social change. And to quote our autopsy report, "This is about more than just increasing voter turnout. It is about energizing as well as expanding the base of the party. To do this, we must aggressively pursue two tracks: fighting right-wing efforts to rig the political system, and giving people who can vote a truly compelling reason to do so," unquote. Related to that is another point in our autopsy, and that is that the enduring point of community outreach is to build an ongoing relationship that aims for the party to become part of the fabric of everyday life. That means acknowledging the validity and power of people-driven movements, as well as recognizing and supporting authentic progressive community leaders. It means focusing on how the party can best serve communities, not the other way around. Most of all, it means persisting with such engagement on an ongoing basis, not just at election time. And before we go to questions, I'd like to just talk a little bit more about the autopsy's recommendations in terms of party policies and programs, more outward-facing social change opportunities that we all have and that the party should be engaged in and seeking. The report says, quoting here, the party should avidly promote inspiring programs such as single-payer Medicare for all, free public college tuition, economic security, infrastructure and green jobs initiatives, and tackling the climate crisis. There's also the reality that engagement with people of color has been sorely lacking. It's reflected by the party's budget expenditures. As Karen mentioned, there have been recent revelations and critiques of how the Democratic Party has spent and not spent its money in the gubernatorial race in Virginia. Steve Phillips had a piece in The Nation just a few days ago spelling out just the paltry amount of money that the Democratic Party has spent in Virginia to reach out to its base, to people of color, to immigrants, to others who have a right to vote, who will vote if they have a good reason to vote. Instead, enormous amounts of money have been spent by the Democratic Party, as was the case last year, and notably again in Virginia, underscoring a lack of learning the lessons from last year, spent by the Democratic Party to chase those who are sometimes called, quote, the persuadables, unquote. But what we've learned is that the so-called persuadables are very rarely persuadable. And so it's a chase often for Republican votes, for the so-called Romney voters, who supposedly will be so repelled by Donald Trump that they're gonna vote Democratic. You can see how well that panned out last year in the presidential race a year ago in November, and we're seeing that same mistake repeated in Virginia. So our autopsy report spells out not only what went wrong, but how this has to be changed in the future for, again, reaching the twin goals of defeating the right wing and building genuine progressive change capacities in this country. The reality as well is, and we go into this in the report, that it's not enough for the Democratic Party to stand for the rights of women in terms of reproductive rights, legal rights under the way that laws are enforced. Although all of that, of course, is absolutely crucial and cannot be compromised upon. But as the report says, in the real world, the well-being of women is indivisible from their economic circumstances and security. To truly advance gender equality, the party needs to fight for the economic rights of all women. And just to sum up here, we talk in the report about the failure of the Democratic Party to listen to or reach out to rural voters, which was catastrophic in Michigan, in Wisconsin, in Pennsylvania and Ohio. And part of that is not aligning with farming families and others against big agriculture and corporate power that has been so decimating in so many rural communities. And also a parallel is that the party needs to be willing to move beyond tepid proposals like cap and trade to really take on big oil and the big energy conglomerates in terms of fighting against the extremely ominous, catastrophic climate change that's already upon us. So the last quote I want to give before I ask for questions is sort of a sum up from the autopsy report. What must now take place includes honest self-reflection and confronting a hard truth that many view the party, the Democratic Party, as often in service to a rapacious oligarchy and increasingly out of touch with people in its own base. The Democratic Party should disentangle itself ideologically and financially from Wall Street, the military-industrial complex, and other corporate interests that put profits ahead of public needs. And with that, I want to ask for questions. Are there any questions here? Yes.
Social movement, what are they, and do we have a candidate that will be able to get them, get those?
The question is about social movements and what are they, and are there some candidates on the horizon who might be part of them? I'll defer to Karen on this. Karen Bernal.
Well, to answer that question, I think we need to, we see the deficit. Going back to 2010 when the Occupy movement came up, we could see that there was mass discontent in the streets, especially with students, and generally this is where we began to hear the phrase, we are the 99%. And a lot of the framing that Bernie Sanders talked about in his campaign, the 99% versus the 1%, that came to become even more mainstream. I think what we see right now, we see the party basically eschewing this kind of framing of issues. There still isn't a class consciousness within their lexicon. And when we look at candidates that are coming up, a lot of people may say that Bernie may run again. We know that Elizabeth Warren has been at the national level quite a leading figure talking about these things. And certainly there has been a wave of candidates that have come into the political scene that are running for office, that have put themselves up for Congress, for state elected positions. Interestingly, the establishment has also answered in kind and put up their corporate Democrats against many of these much more class conscious candidates. So it remains to be seen how this battle and how this war for the soul of the party is going to play out. It's unfortunate, but there's evidence that there's the base wants there to be a change, and just recently the Harvard-Harris poll noted when they did their poll of registered Democrats that 52% of the respondents wants the party to go in a much more progressive direction.
And I want to add that it's the responsibility, or should be the taken responsibility, of a political party not only to follow the lead of social movements, or some might say tail and try to co-opt social movements, which should not be the role, but also there should be leadership provided by the party and party leaders. That's what being visionary, that's what leadership should be about. And a great example is the warfare state that we live in, the fact that for more than 15 years, the United States has been engaged in perpetual war with no end in sight. We devote a section of the autopsy report to war and the party. We point out that a lot of the Democratic Party base, as verified by polling, is opposed to the militarism that has become routinely deferred to by the Democratic Party leadership on Capitol Hill. And we note in the autopsy report that Democrats are fond of routinely citing and quoting "I Have a Dream" for Martin Luther King Jr., and yet refuse to acknowledge his condemnation of what he called the madness of militarism and his explicit connecting of, on one hand, the way in which spending for warfare for the Pentagon goes on and is not in any way anything but a deficit for domestic concerns. So here we have a Democratic Party that likes to quote Dr. King, but cherry picks and avoids really acknowledging what he stood for, what he worked for, particularly in the last years of his life. When we have Democrats on Capitol Hill and the DNC who say, oh, we must spend a bit more, some more money for meeting domestic needs, and they refuse to acknowledge, as Dr. King explicitly acknowledged, that when you, as he put it, if you spend all that money on guns, you forget guns and butter, as he said, you don't even get good oleomargarine. And that's where we are. And we go through communities in this country, and they're absolutely decimated. You drive through any city in this country, and if you drive very much and not selectively, you will see the decimation of our own communities. This is true in rural areas as well. And yet the militarism that is depleting our resources and capacities in this country, that militarism is being fed from the top of the Democratic Party as well as the Republican Party. One more thing I want to note before we go on to the next question, that an organization that has been very strong in challenging militarism in this society, as well as fighting for many progressive causes across the board, is the group Progressive Democrats of America. And the executive director of Progressive Democrats of America, Donna Smith, asked me to announce at the news conference here today that the organization, Progressive Democrats of America, endorses this autopsy report and will distribute it to its members. And I think this is a good step, because it's not only rootsaction.org, which is committed to, with our 1.3 million active online members in the United States, to distributing this report, to reaching out to members of Congress who are Democrats in the House and Senate, to other elected officials, to Democratic clubs, to activists who are unaffiliated, and urging them to go to, on the web, democraticautopsy.org, to make this a springboard for change in this country. It's not only that we're reaching out in that way, but we're also encouraging other groups to get behind the autopsy and use it as a social organizing tool. And I'm very glad that Progressive Democrats of America has already, with the autopsy just out, endorsed its findings, endorsed the report, and is committed to moving forward with it. Are there questions we might have? Yes.
Yeah, could you address more how you think Trump sort of played into the weaknesses of the Democratic Party here? You mentioned war. He, on Alternative Tuesdays, painted himself as anti-interventionist, and also on issues like trade, where this quote-unquote progressive position, at times it wasn't clear on some issues, at least, who was more progressive if you take, you know, stated positions as actual positions.
Right. The question is about how Trump was able to relate to and sometimes play into the way in which the Democratic Party and the Democratic ticket approached specific issues. And I think those two issues are great examples of how the Democratic Party, the leadership, the ticket, actually opened themselves up to being played and exploited and demagogued by the Trump campaign. One is on the issue of war. We document in the report that there's a academic study indicating strongly that the Clinton campaign lost votes appreciably in key swing states in communities the hardest hit by casualties, by deaths, by injuries, by PTSD, loved ones and neighbors who were lost or injured or harmed by intervention in Iraq and Afghanistan, that in those communities hardest hit, there was a deficit of voting for the Democratic ticket. And of course, Hillary Clinton was very much identified as a hawk, a very strong hawk, much more so in the public mind and in reality, apparently, than Barack Obama. And that aggressive militarism that Hillary Clinton intentionally put forward during the campaign was exploited and whiplashed by the Trump campaign, who, as always, had a dual discourse, and so he tried to, and Hillary Clinton made it easier for him to have it both ways, where he was talking about how he was going to light the deserts on fire with U.S. firepower, and the U.S. was going to crush and smite its foes, but at the same time, he spoke against intervention and against nation building and against wars that he felt he could benefit from seeming to oppose. And that is a very good parallel with trade as well, because Hillary Clinton, while she had supported the TPP, had supported NAFTA, of course, as President Clinton did, she, because of pressure from the progressive wing of the party, she began to waffle and then say, after all, the gold standard of the TPP wasn't so good after all, and then she was sort of kind of against it. That again was a parallel, because in a demagogic populist way, Donald Trump was able to portray the Clinton campaign as a standard bearer for the status quo, including unfair trade deals. And Karen, you might have some thoughts on this.
Yeah. Actually, he did. He saw the opening there and exploited it for all it was worth. And we saw quite a few. Although I don't think that it determined the outcome of the party necessarily in of itself, we saw quite a few of the working class voters, particularly white working class voters, that went from supporting Bernie in the primary to supporting Trump in the general election. At the DNC convention itself, we heard refrains of no TPP along with no more war over and over on the floor of the convention. The base of the party itself were opposed to these neoliberal policies, and they were for fighting for a $15 minimum wage, for free college tuition, and against these multinational corporate trade deals, which the party leadership was promoting very aggressively. That should have told the Democratic Party where the people were at. Unfortunately, Trump, early on in his campaign, talked about these trade deals, has framed them negatively, that we should be against them. And later on, of course, he said, we need to renegotiate them, which is kind of his way of rolling back on that. But at that time, he knew absolutely to exploit this weakness that the Democratic Party was continuing to promote. So in that regard, the Democratic Party walked right into that. They had the chance to change. They certainly could have brought on. They could have, at least in messaging, talked in a much more populist tongue. But there was almost a rejection of this kind of embrace of populism, and it was very obvious going back to the time of Occupy that more and more this kind of collective mindset among the electorate was taking hold. So not to mention the fact of a lot of other things going on, such as police brutality and the activism around that. We saw a lot of, with Black Lives Matter, many protests and rallies in the street. But this is also a reflection not just about race, but about oppression in general. And as manifested in the Black and communities and people and of color communities. So the party neglected to pick up on this and speak to this. And again, these are the communities that would be their base, the working class, communities of color, students, women, all of these, their very base was pursuit of prioritizing their needs was eschewed in favor of going after an ever-shrinking universe of voters, the suburban white voters or the white working class. As I mentioned before, the working class cohort and the communities of color are going to intersect soon. And therefore, the party needs to prioritize and think of their needs together. And it remains to be seen if that's happening.
Do we have any other questions? Anyone else? Yes.
Intense needs of the voters instead of focusing on external international issues?
Well, the autopsy really emphasizes that the pressure is going to have to come, the creative energy is going to have to come from the grassroots, whether people call themselves Democrats or anything else. The heat is going to have to be turned way up to reprioritize out of the appropriations process on Capitol Hill. When you look at the fiscal 2018 military budget that's just been passed in the last few weeks, you can count on one hand the number of Democrats who voted against it and still have a finger or two left over. Bernie Sanders voted against it. You had a few, again, less than five, total of eight senators as a whole out of 100 voting against it, but I was going to say less than five Republicans. You had Rand Paul and a couple of others. And so you've got essentially 90% of the Congress, or the Senate in that case, voting for this astronomical boost in military spending at a time when the U.S. government is already spending more on military than the other 9 or 10 most military spending countries on the planet. So it's just out of control. And the only way that those priorities are going to change to spend on infrastructure, green jobs, anti-climate change programs, public education, K through 12, free public college, things that are vastly popular with the polling but not popular with elites, the only changes are going to come from the grassroots.
And I just wanted to say that, in addition, Norman, it's not only more than the next 10 countries, but the next 10 countries combined.
Right.
So, I mean, that's an important point. And I think the majority of those countries are our allies to boot, so it's completely unnecessary. The other thing noted is that for the increase in spending that they have done over time, the student debt could be wiped out. And just on that alone, it could be wiped out. And we see right now that there is poverty created by the student debt. Going to higher education is really now become a class issue, because no one can afford to go to school. And we see poverty being created by just trying to get an education. And when we have such massive student debt, this is another thing that was driving the popularity of Bernie Sanders, was that discussion. Military spending, they have no problem with subsidizing, but they can't seem to do this with higher education. And we need a redirection of our priorities, and that's what this report is calling for, in addition to pointing out the mistakes.
Yes, did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. You mentioned rural voters, and I guess that's a big divide, and the Democratic Party is more associated with urban areas. So how is that going to go about, and what about President Obama's responsibility? I mean, he was the leader of the party for 8 years, so.
Well, the question is, well, how would rural voters be spoken to creatively and effectively by the Democratic Party? And as you point out in the question, Barack Obama, president for 8 years. If you actually look at the data, and at the Media Watch Group Fair, the editor of its magazine, Jim Noriekis, recently wrote a piece on this. You look on the data of what happened in the U.S. House and U.S. Senate and state legislatures during the 8 years of Bill Clinton's presidency and during the 8 years of Barack Obama's presidency, and it was a wipeout. We hear from the punditocracy how Bill Clinton was this great leader. He was a moderate Democrat, a new Democrat in the jargon of the era. Generally, that's been a positive assessment of Barack Obama. And yet, if, for instance, Barack Obama was such a positive leader with his corporatism that dominated his cabinet and his policies, why during those 8 years did he preside over the decimation of the prospects and the seats of legislators from the 50 state capitals to Capitol Hill here in Washington? And the answer is that largely it was a willingness to let those Democratic candidates who lost fall under the bus, so to speak, because the corporate policies that President Obama was able to implement were very unpopular in the country. And I think this applies to the question here about rural areas, because there's a failure to recognize quite often the tremendous progressive populist history that this country has in rural areas, in the lower southern part of the Midwest, in the upper Midwest. Bob La Follette fighting Bob from Wisconsin. We have a history, a heritage of very strong rural populism that has been destroyed, I think, in large measure by the failure of progressives and the Democratic Party to hold firm to basic, genuine populist progressive principles, which has to include fighting the big banks, the oligarchy, and corporations. And our autopsy talks about the need, if the Democratic Party is going to reconnect with people who live in rural areas, the absolute need to, without any equivocation, stand up against big agriculture, the Cargills, the enormous companies that are wreaking such environmental and economic damage in rural areas. And let's not forget that there are programs that can be implemented, like rural broadband, if Democrats would fight more effectively for it and did not do a great job during those 8 years under Obama. It's only because the federally qualified health centers, which are so important in underserved rural areas, were championed by Bernie Sanders that it got into the Obamacare final, the ACA final legislation. Bernie made that, if you will, the cost of his vote for Obamacare. He said, these federally qualified health centers are absolutely crucial for people who otherwise will be at the mercy of little or no health care at all. So it comes down to a progressive program fighting for a progressive program if rural areas are going to be lived in by people who actually give a damn about the Democratic Party. Yeah, the question of restructuring what it means to be affiliated with or a quote-unquote member of the Democratic Party, and as you point out, that change in Britain under the Labour Party really helped to surge Jeremy Corbyn, to the astonishment of the pundits, to almost becoming prime minister. We talk in the report about the need to democratize inside the party, at least to the extent of eliminating superdelegates to help choose the presidential candidate and so forth, and also democratizing so that, as is clearly the case, what happened in 2016, the DNC can no longer have its thumbs on the scale in the nominating process. That has to end, so we're emphatic about that. I think the question of what it even means to be a member of the Democratic Party is very ambiguous right now, because you can be a registered Democrat, but, you know, membership hardly exists in any other meaningful sense other than people being elected to the party structures, which is really a very small percentage of the population. And Karen Bernal, as the chair of the largest state party's Progressive Caucus, the California Democratic Party, what are your thoughts on that, Karen?
Well, before I answer that, I want to just also point out We've lost 1,000 seats across the country in legislative houses, and really we're at this point, and this all happened during the 8 years of Obama. We are now only in control of 6 of those states out of all of the state six. So, and this was a long time coming. You know, let's face it, after all, I think part of the problem that Hillary Clinton had was she was seen as a standard bearer for so many policies that we were now, and the part and the electorate, the base of the party was in utter rejection of. And unfortunately for her, all of these things, the depression of the African American vote in the final 4 years of Obama's administration, the rise of social movements rejecting neoliberal policies, it all came home. It came home to roost in the 2016 election. And so it was a perfect or terrible storm. Regarding the party, I think one thing that we can see, at least speaking as someone who is a delegate to a large state party, who finds herself quite often in a lot of battles of the delegates up against party leadership, we have found that everything resides in how a party is structured and also the rules. And you will find, just like we did just recently with the DNC meeting in Las Vegas, the party at least has to give lip service and acknowledgement to the barbarians at the gate, so to speak, and the people that are pushing. So in this regard, they passed some pretty progressive resolutions. Now, resolutions, and I don't want to minimize that, the importance of that, because at least it is some sort of acknowledgement and recognition of the fact of the mindset and the sentiment that is out there with a Democratic base. And they passed resolutions about voter disenfranchisement and also about not accepting corporate money if those corporations did not promote their values, I think was the wording. But this doesn't matter because those resolutions are non-binding, and what's more, at the same time, they did consolidate power in their purges of the very small number of people that were sitting on the Rules and Bylaws Committee. Now that Rules and Bylaws Committee is bereft of anyone that supported Bernie Sanders or Keith Ellison. And this Rules and Bylaws Committee will be the body that determines the process and rules and procedures for the next presidential election. When you combine that with the appointment of corporate lobbyists that to the at-large committees and to the superdelegates, what you begin to see is, one, we were going to put out there for consumption these, we recognize and we have these progressive resolutions that we've passed, but at the same time, behind the scenes, what they're doing is consolidating power even more and also rewarding the extremely wealthy donor class. And that's another trend that we're seeing that I think needs to be written about even more, which is that the donor class has been rewarded. And that, in fact, I mentioned earlier about some progressive candidates that have decided to run for office as part of this wave of progressive populism. Part of the answer from the party has been to put up corporate candidates who themselves, the common thread seems to be that they themselves in the past were wealthy donors or they were bundlers for wealthy donors. So we're beginning to see the wealthy donor class stepping up to run for office. So that's one of the things that I think is going to be developing even more as we go forward.
I think we have time for one more question, if there is another question. Yes.
I was just wondering, since the political climate is changing so fast, do you think that the DNC has the mindset or the staffing to keep up the relevance with voters?
The question, does the DNC have the mindset the resources or the approach to keep up with the change in the political climate? Is that the question? Well, you know, it remains to be seen. We're through this autopsy report, which was released at the beginning of this week on October 30th, and has gotten a very strong response. Our website at democraticautopsy.org has been getting thousands of visits every day, and that's just from a dead start where nobody had heard of it. We kept it under wraps till Monday morning this week. So I'm optimistic the coverage the autopsy is getting and the broader pressure that the autopsy is just part of across the country from the grassroots, only that kind of pressure is going to compel the DNC. I mean, very frankly, right now, the Democratic National Committee is in a state of stasis. It is, it's like watching paint dry slowly, and it's not energizing. There's nobody at the top of the DNC that would remotely be described as inspiring, and there's a reflex at the DNC to assume that you do all the number crunching and inspiration doesn't matter and grassroots energy doesn't matter, and you can see how well that approach worked for the Clinton campaign in 2016. So whether we have grounds for hope depends on how well we organize. Left to their own devices, the Democratic National Committee will not change. We've got to make sure they aren't left to their own devices. We need to organize and pressure. And I'll leave the final word here to Karen Bernal, who I want to remind you is chair of the Progressive Caucus of the California Democratic Party. And I want to thank everybody who's here and who's viewing us online. And again, invite you to go to read the autopsy at democraticautopsy.org.
One of the things I want to talk about is structure. It is very important. We are not suggesting that the change is only going to come from the inside, but it's important to note that we have to pay attention and we have to be a part of social movements, and that's going to continue. The party is not going to change, as Norman said. It is not an agent of change, but what it needs to do is respond to the environment and respond to change. And while we need social movements to continue to be strong, and we need to do everything that we can to encourage and support them and be allies and be a part of these social movements, let's face it, without us going into the party, and I really, I am encouraging people to join parties, to join the Democratic Party, and be a part of the leftward push. The structure of the party, which would facilitate these kinds of progressive changes, won't happen unless we are there making the push. And so, with that in mind, I hope that there are other progressive caucuses that are established, and that the network of progressive caucuses and state parties communicate with each other and be a part of the internal push to force the party to change, to become more democratic in a small d democratic kind of way. And that's pretty much, you know, from the inside perspective as an outside street activist. So that's what I have to say.
And I'd like to thank everybody for being here, and see you at democraticautopsy.org.